Hi everyone. In today's video, we are going to talk about annotations within Java. An annotation is metadata that you can attach to a class. You can attach it to different elements of that class, whether it is the class itself, a field, or methods. And the usage of annotations really is quite extensive. If you've been coding in Java for a little while, you've probably already come across a few, whether it's the deprecated annotation, the overwrite annotation, suppress warnings. There are multiple others that are built into the language, but today I want to focus on making our own custom annotation, and our annotation is going to be available at runtime, meaning that the reflection API with Java will be able to access them. If you need a quick refresher on reflection, I'd highly recommend you check out one of my previous videos on reflection. Without further ado, let's get into IntelliJ and look at some examples. So to start, let's look at an annotation that you're probably already familiar with, the override annotation. All right, so here's an example of an annotation, the @override annotation, which is actually a special type of annotation called a marker, meaning that it doesn't take any parameters, which we'll get into here later. This annotation is a compile time annotation, meaning when the compiler is processing this annotation, it's verifying that the method that it is describing actually does what's called method overwriting, where we're providing an implementation in our subclass for a method defined within, in this case, our parent class. So in this case, our @override annotation is applying to the method one method. If I were to have the @override annotation added onto the class, I do get an error. And that's because @override is not applicable to type. So how's the annotation smart enough to know if I am applying it to a class versus a method? Let's go ahead and look at the definition of override, and it'll tell us. An annotation can be annotated by other annotations. Who would have guessed, right? And this target annotation, the first one here, can take either a single value or an array of values representing target element types that can accept the annotation. So in our case, a method can accept the override annotation. And that brings us to the second annotation here, the retention annotation, which is a little bit difficult to understand. But if you take a step back and think about what an annotation is, think of an annotation as just some metadata. You're tacking on a little bit of extra data to your actual class logic here. Your class logic isn't changing just because you added this extra little tag. But if you have code over here that wants to look at this tag and then do something, then it could affect your class behavior. So we need to determine how long this tag is going to be associated with my actual class data. And there are three different retention policies. The first one is at source level, which means that at compilation, when the compiler is looking at your source code, the compiler will see it. But then when the compiler is done processing your source code file, it'll take out the annotation. The second one is at what's called class level, which is actually the default behavior. And basically what that means is the compiler compiles your Java code and it also attaches your annotation onto it. But then when you go to actually run your code, the virtual machine doesn't have to look at your tag, your annotation. It just takes your actual bytecode. And then the third type is runtime. And that's the one you see quite often with custom annotations. And that is, at runtime, I can now use reflection to determine if my class that was compiled over here was compiled with a particular annotation. So in the case of the override annotation, the retention policy is source. Therefore, I could not use reflection in order to figure out if this particular annotation was present. Now that we've gone through an example of the override annotation, which looks at it at the source level, let's shift gears and look at an annotation that is runtime available, and we'll make a custom annotation to do that. So to do that, we'll create a new Java class, which will actually be an annotation called custom annotation. So as usual, we start with the public access modifier like we would typically expect for other types within Java. And then we have this interesting syntax, which is @interface. So @interface means that you are about to declare an annotation. Now let's modify our annotation to have it restricted to particular targets. So I mentioned that you can either have a singular value or an array. Let's go ahead and show what it would look like for an array, but we'll just have a singular value within here. So we want to do element type. And in this case, I'm going to do element type, and you would think it would be element type.class, but it's actually element type.type. And this type right here refers to what we would normally consider a type within Java, which could be a class, interface, annotation, enum, or record. What it doesn't include would be things like methods or fields. And then I also mentioned we want the retention on this one. Instead of being source, we want to use a retention policy of runtime, which means that at runtime, we can use reflection to see if our classes are annotated with our custom annotation. So within our main class, let's just go ahead and put this into practice. We'll just say class one, and I'll go ahead and make another one of these just to demonstrate both cases. So class one and class two. So now let's make an instance of our class one. And then let's use reflection to determine if we have the annotation present. And to do that, now you need to pass in the class type of the annotation class. So this returns true if it is annotated with the custom annotation. So let's print. Yes, it is. So if we run the code currently, we'll see that we don't get any printouts. But if we change our code to annotate class one with our custom annotation, we can see that yes, it is annotated with our custom annotation. Now, just to demonstrate retention policies, if I go back to my custom annotation and I change this to source, and then I rerun the code, you will notice that even though I didn't change that class one was annotated with custom annotation, Java no longer picks it up. And that's entirely due to how the retention policy works. Similarly, if I were to comment out this code, it's going to do the default value of class level retention, which means it's in the bytecode, but not at runtime. And likewise, reflection can't see it. So the important thing here to remember is if you want your annotations to be available for reflection, you have to specify a retention policy of runtime. So now that we've talked about annotating a class, let's annotate methods. So in this case, what I want to do is I want to be able to annotate if a particular method within a class is supposed to be considered a test or not. You'll see this quite often in unit test frameworks. And what I'll say is I'll do class unit tester. And then I'll add a method one that is not going to be marked as a test. And then let's go ahead and create some more methods. We'll say method 2, 3, and 4. Now what I want to do is I want to annotate method 2 and 3 as tests. So this at test annotation doesn't exist yet. So let's go ahead and fix that. So I'm going to refactor our existing annotation to be called test. And then we also need to change the element type to methods. And then we'll leave this as a runtime retention policy. And if we go back, now the errors are gone. And now here's where things can get pretty cool. So let's say that I want to create an instance in my unit tester. And then now that I have an instance, what I can do is I can say for every method within my tester, dot get declared methods. So now I'm looping over every method within the unit tester class, and I can do method dot is annotation present, and I can say test dot class. I gotta wrap that in if. So if the test annotation is present, then I can run the method with the method.invoke method using reflection. And then I need to pass in the instance that this method is associated with, which is the tester object. And now invoke can throw a lot of different exceptions. So I'm just going to say that main could throw exception. So now to verify that invoke is actually getting called on the right methods, I'll just add some very basic implementations for each of these. So now here we're printing out which method we're invoking. And if we run the code, lo and behold, we can see that we are running methods 2 and 3. And if I wanted to create my own little unit test framework, what I could do is I could have all of my at test annotated methods return a Boolean or just not throw an exception if they were successful. And then I could count up the number of successful tests, and I could actually write my own unit testing framework just using annotations and reflection. Pretty neat, right? So everything that we've talked about so far is what's called a marker, meaning an annotation that doesn't take any parameters. And there is a shorthand you can use with markers that you'll sometimes see, and that is people have them on the same line and they just look like another modifier within the method or the class declaration. You see this periodically, especially in somewhat terse code that might use a lot of annotations, but a lot of the time folks will put annotations on their own line, because another form of annotation that's often seen is what's called a single element annotation interface. And that is something like this. So let's have this string represent the name of the test that we're writing. So let's call it test number one, and then let's have test number two. And now I want to update my annotation interface to be able to accept this string parameter. So to do that, if I go back to test.java, I indicate that I am looking for a string parameter, and then it looks like I'm going to write a method called value. But it's not really a method per se. It's a little bit odd. It looks like a method when you access the annotation at runtime via reflection, but when you're passing in the parameter to the annotation, it's not really a method. So it's kind of a special value for an annotation parameter. And these can take default values. So let's say that I don't want to specify a value by default. I can just put in an empty string. The reason I'm calling this value is because if I were to call this something else, such as test, now what I have to do is I need to specify test equals within here. Test equals. But if I want to omit that extra syntax, then Java has a special name for a single element annotation interface, and that is a value. And that represents the value of the annotation when you've got a single element within your annotation interface. So let's update our code to see how we can use this new value within our annotation. So now let's say in my unit test framework, I want to print out the name of my test before I run it. So I can do that by grabbing the annotation from the method. And then I'll store this in a local variable called annotation. And then I will do annotation.value. And then if I print it out and run the code, we can see that we print out our test name, and then we execute our actual test method. So let's say I wanted to further edit my annotation, and instead of just having a name here, I want to also indicate if when the test fails, if I need to abort everything, or if I just need to continue running my other tests. So let's go ahead and change this to name. And then let's have a Boolean called abort with a default value of false. So let's say that test one, if it fails, I need to abort. Abort true. And then test two, I have to say name now, but I don't have to specify abort false because the default for the abort Boolean is false already. And now what this allows me is if I want to make this logic more complicated in the future, if invoke, let's say, returns a Boolean if it was successful, or let's say that if invoke doesn't throw a particular type of exception, I'm going to consider it successful. Then what I could do is I could check that, and then I could either abort or I could continue. I hope this gives some ideas of things that you can do with runtime type annotations. There are other annotation types that could be used at source level or at class level that are pretty interesting case studies. The Lombok library, for instance, has annotations that allow you to annotate a field as a getter or setter, and it automatically generates getters and setters for you. Pretty cool, right? Those sorts of annotations are pretty cool because basically what they do is rather than use reflection at runtime, they use what's called annotation processing at compilation time to generate custom code from annotations that then the compiler then compiles at that point. The point is annotations are extremely versatile and you can use them for all sorts of different reasons, and a lot of different frameworks out there utilize them heavily. So it's important to know how to use them. And that was an overview of creating your own custom annotation that is usable at runtime and accessed via reflection. I really hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, please do smash that like button. If you're enjoying the channel and you haven't had a chance to subscribe yet, please do take a moment to do so now. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.